Can someone confirm if I'm audible?
Yes, sir.
So we can get started. So what was the topic we were discussing yesterday?
Sir. Sir, I have a doubt, sir.
Yeah, tell me. Whatever.
Sir, what is the difference between translatory and tangential velocity?
Okay, I'll come to that point. Just a minute, I'm opening my documents. If there is a circular object there, okay, and the circular object is moving on a ground in this direction, okay, then this object is said to have a translational motion, accepted, and if you treat this whole ring as a single particle, then the translatory velocity that this particle, okay, here the keyword is particle, the translatory velocity that the particle has, sorry, the velocity that the particle has is what is called as translatory velocity or translational velocity. Okay, whereas if I take the ring itself and if I try to measure the speed of the ring, speed of the particles on the ring, in the case of its rotation, suppose the ring is revolving with an angular velocity omega, then let's say about the center of the mass, then each particle will have a tangential velocity of r omega. Okay. So to put it in simple terms, you define the concept of tangential velocity when the particle is moving in a curved path. For example, if I take a parabolic motion, parabola is a curve. So if I take this curve into consideration, then at each point, if I ask you what is the direction of velocity, you need to draw the tangent in the direction of its motion. That's what is called as tangential velocity. Everyone understand? So this object, we cannot say it has translational velocity, it has only tangential velocity. Everybody understand? So tangential velocity is defined at every point on the path of the particle. Okay. Whereas translational velocity is a common thing when the object is sliding or it is moving in a straight line path. That's it.
Sir, then what's the difference between tangential and rotational velocity?
Tangential and rotation, there is nothing like rotational velocity as such. When it comes to rotation, we define only the angular velocity. This angular velocity is sometimes referred to as angular frequency also.
Sir, then yesterday, what is VR, sir?
Which one? Where did I show? What is? Which one? Which place are you at?
Here only, sir. V1.
VR is, I wanted to mention that it is the velocity attained by the particle due to revolution. Or I can say due to rotation. But still, I wrote the tangential velocity only. So, VCM is the translational velocity plus R omega is the tangential velocity attained by the particle at whichever point you consider. For instance, at point P1. So both these velocities will get added if they are in the same direction. They'll get subtracted if they are in the opposite direction. I hope I answered your question. Yeah? Shall I proceed? Okay. So So yesterday I remember explaining the concept of radius of gyration also. Just to recollect that concept, let me ask you something. See, for a hollow cylinder, moment of inertia about the center of mass is mr square. It's mr square. Okay. What is the radius of gyration? Answer. It's just one step. Why is it taking so much time? So radius of gyration, what are we supposed to do? Mr square should be equated to mk square. M and m will get cancelled. K will be equal to r. Right? See, for example, if I talk about a hollow sphere. Okay. What is the moment of inertia? It is 2 by 3 mr square. What is the radius of gyration?
So root 2 by 3.
That's it. Root 2 by 3 what?
R, sir.
Yes. So square root of 2 by 3 r. So if you have this clarity, that is sufficient. Now listen, let us take a problem and then try to solve it. So this is the problem that we are going to solve. So whatever concepts we discussed yesterday, we will be applying all those concepts to this problem. Okay, I want everybody to concentrate. If there is any doubt, get it clarified. So there are three objects. What are three objects? You have a ring, a solid cylinder, and a solid sphere, which roll down the same inclined plane without slipping. So if you see the concept of rolling without slipping, what are the things that should come to your mind? First thing, the point in contact with ground should be at dash. Second, velocity of the center of mass is equal to dash. Or both these things I explained yesterday. Recollect and tell me.
Sir, is the first one rest?
First one is rest, correct. Second one, VCM is equal to, I told you that is the condition for pure rolling. If you have taken down notes, you will have, you can recollect it.
Zero, sir.
No. VCM cannot be zero. VCM is the velocity of the center of mass. If it is zero, how can you claim the translative motion? Check your notes. I would have put a box and written that this is the condition for pure rolling. Please remember this again. Yes. VCM should be equal to R omega. Next time, don't forget. So, wherever you see rolling without slipping, then VCM should be equal to R omega. So, they start from rest. Initial velocity is zero. The radii of the objects are identical. All objects have same radius. Which of the bodies reaches the ground with maximum velocity? Okay. So, let me consider one of the objects. Let us say this is the ring. Okay. So tell me one thing, guys. Just because the radius is same, see, suppose I say mass of, they never mentioned anything about mass in the question because I was looking for it. They didn't mention anything. Suppose I assume that mass is same for all the three objects. Since they have mentioned radius is also same, can I say that the moment of inertia of all the three objects is the same? I reiterate, if I take mass to be same, they have mentioned that the radius is same for all the three particles. Can I conclude that the moment of inertia is the same for all the particles? That is for ring, solid cylinder, and solid sphere. Is it possible?
No, sir.
Why? Because they have different values. Though the mass and radius are same, we cannot conclude anything with respect to moment of inertia. Okay, so what are we supposed to do is, we need to take the moment of inertia of these particles in terms of radius of variation for our job to become simple. Because radius of variation based moment of inertia has only one formula. What is it? Mk square. The value of k, you can find it out. See, for example, if it is a solid sphere, you can substitute root 2 by 5 times r. For it is a solid cylinder, it is r by root 2. For a ring, it is r. So, but the common formula will be in terms of radius of variation. At that point, what we can do is, we can substitute the value of radius of variation. Right? So, if I take the height of the cylinder to be h, okay, now, tell me one thing. If the object is rolling, okay, if the object is rolling, can I say that initial potential energy is converted to kinetic energy at the bottom? So when it is converted to the kinetic energy at bottom, the object will have both rotational kinetic energy and translational kinetic energy. It means BCM will be present and omega will be present. Because they mentioned clearly that the object is rolling. So tell me one thing, guys. What is the initial potential energy that each object has? Can I say it is mgh is equal to, what is the kinetic energy? It is translational kinetic energy plus rotational kinetic energy. So, which is going to be half into m into vcm square plus, can I write it as half I omega square? Can I write something like this, guys? Right. So, mgh is equal to half m vcm square plus half into, in the place of I, can I write it as mk square, and in the place of omega, can I write it as vcm by r the whole square? Right. Now, what we get cancelled? M is gone. Right. So, gh is equal to vcm square by 2 plus k square divided by r square into vcm square divided by 2. So 2 will go to the other side. 2gh will be equal to vcm square into 1 plus k square divided by r square. So what is the value of vcm, guys? Root of 2gh divided by 1 plus k square divided by r square. Now we understand why they have not mentioned anything about mass in the problem. Because the velocity with which the object is going to reach the bottom is independent of mass. So 2gh divided by 1 plus k square divided by r square. Now, tell me one thing. For ring, what is the value of k? For solid sphere, the value of k. For solid cylinder, the value of k. So for a ring, what is the value of K, guys?
R.
Correct. Solid sphere. Solid cylinder, R by root 2. So take all these values, substitute it here. Whichever value is more, that object will reach with the greatest velocity. Okay? So that's all with this problem. I want everybody to copy this.
So in case in this question, if the objects did not roll, then the formula would be only root of 2 GH, right?
Yes, if the object didn't roll, it is only root of 2
GH. And how is solid sphere root of 2 by 5?
No, here it is rolling, you know, they mentioned rolling. All the objects are rolling.
No, sir, I'm asking the value of K for solid sphere.
What is the moment of inertia? It is 2 by 5 mR square. That is equal to mk square. Cancel it. K will be equal to root of 2 by 5 times.
Okay.
Look at this. Copy it, guys.
Sir?
Yeah,
sir, have they mentioned the height in the problem?
No, they didn't mention it, but what you can do is you can take the proportionality. They didn't mention the height. See, for example, they asked which one will reach with maximum velocity, right? So VCM is equal to, if I forget about root of 2 GH, okay, this is a constant divided by 1 plus, in the case of ring, it will be 1. In the case of a solid sphere, it will be 2 by 5. In the case of solid cylinder, it will be root of 2 GH divided by 1 plus K square by R square, that will be half. So what is the answer? 1 by 2, 5 by 7, and here it is 2 by 3. So which one is more? 2
by 3.
So that will be the answer, that it reached the ground with maximum velocity. Yeah, 2 by 3. So that it reached the ground with maximum velocity, that's it. So you have nothing to do with height because you will be taking the proportionality thing into consideration. Okay.
Okay, sir.
Sir, how is 1 plus 1 half, sir?
Where 1 plus 1 is half? Here I wrote
nothing, sir. Got it, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay. So we are done with this concept also. See, that's what they have done it in a different way. But I hope you would have understood by now.
Sir, actually it's 5 by 7 only.
5 by 7 is more. How much is 5? It's coming 0.7, no? Yeah, this is 0.5, this 0.7 something, this 0.6 something. So this is higher. So the sphere will reach the bottom with a greater velocity. So they have mentioned, from the three results obtained, it is clear that among the three bodies, the sphere has the highest and the greatest. Sorry, sphere has the greatest and the ring has the least velocity of the center of mass at the bottom of the inclined plane. So, I hope this concept is clear.
Yes, sir.
Rolling motion is what we are done with. So, the last concept that is left out in this chapter is angular momentum and conservation of angular momentum. Okay, we'll be completing that today. And Monday and Tuesday, we'll try to concentrate more on problems. Next Wednesday, we can start gravitation chapter. That is only two classes. That's all. That will be completed. So, shall we start angular momentum? Please write down the heading as angular momentum in your notes. So, the heading is angular momentum about a fixed axis. See, whenever you're talking about rotation, okay, the one thumb rule that needs to be in your mind strongly is, if you see the word rotation, okay, I repeat, if you see the word rotation, the first and the foremost question that you need to ask anyone or you need to check for in the question is, what is the axis about which the object is revolving? Okay, if they ask if they ask any question without mentioning the axis, it is invalid. For example, what is the moment of inertia of a ring? Invalid. About which point are we talking about? Secondly, what is the torque experienced by the particle? Invalid. Why? Because you are talking about the torque about which axis, right? So whichever is the reason for rotational motion to take place, that is not possible without an axis. The first and the foremost point to be noted. I hope I am clear, right? In a similar way, when you talk about an angular momentum also, you will have a fixed axis. See, suppose I take this as the fixed axis. And there is a particle P which is having a velocity V and mass M. Okay, let's say something like this is existing. Now, this particle P, let's say it is at a distance R from the axis of rotation. Okay. Then look at the way I'm going to define angular momentum. Moment of linear momentum. Okay. So moment of linear momentum is what is called as angular momentum. Now, with the knowledge that you have, can you guys tell me what do we mean by moment of force? Can you guys tell me what is meant by moment of force? What is the other name for moment of force?
Force experienced by body in rotation.
Okay. See, we learned something like this, right? There is an object and there is a force acting on this object. And if I take this distance as R, then the moment of force is defined something like this, R vector cross P vector. What is this we technically called as? Is this not the torque? So if the word moment comes here, we are including the distance from the axis of rotation into consideration. So moment of force is R vector cross P vector. Similarly, moment of linear momentum, how should I write it as? R vector cross
MV.
Or I will write it as P vector, or this is equal to R vector cross MV vector, and this is what is called as angular momentum, and it is represented by the symbol L and it is also a vector quantity because you are performing cross product. Please write down this term.
Sir, in the second case, isn't it R vector cross F vector?
Yeah. Oh, sorry, I wrote P vector. Sorry, it is F vector. Just to create the similarity between both, I wanted to explain. So it is R vector cross P vector, right? So this is what we call it as angular momentum. Now the question can be asked like this. R vector is equal to I cap minus J cap plus K cap. P vector is equal to K cap minus J cap plus I cap. So both are same. I cap plus J cap minus K cap. Find L vector. Do it fast and tell me. You guys already have knowledge about it. Do it fast and tell me.
So 2j cap plus 2k cap.
2j cap plus
2k cap.
Okay, is everyone getting this? I cap into one, I think you should get 1 minus 1. Correct. Minus J cap into minus 1 minus 1 plus K cap into 1 plus 1. So this will become 0, 2J cap plus 2K cap. Correct. So 2J cap plus 2K cap, if this is in meter, this is in terms of kilogram meter per second, or if it is in terms of Newton second, it can be both. Right, so answer would be in terms of kilogram meter per second or Newton meter second. Right, so that is going to be the SI unit for angular momentum. But I hope you understood that angular momentum is also vector quantity. Right, so this is the formula. Now, the same thing we will see in terms of scalar quantity. So L vector is equal to R vector cross P vector. Then L vector can also be written as R into MV sine theta into N cap, where N cap is a unit vector perpendicular to both R vector and P vector. Okay, that is one more thing. Or if I write only L, I can write it as M into V into R sine theta. Either of them is applicable. So depending on what data they are given in the problem, we can use either of the three formula. Okay. Next is angular momentum in terms of angular momentum in terms of moment of inertia. So angular momentum in terms of moment of inertia. So L is equal to MVR sine theta. For time being, I am taking theta to be 90 degrees, okay? For time being. This is only for showing you the derivation. So if I take it as MVR, Now what I will do is I will write V as r omega and this as r. So m r square into omega. What does m r square stand for with respect to the axis of rotation? It is I into omega. So angular momentum can also be written in terms of I omega. I would have told you the similarities between translatory motion and rotational motion, right? So translational, rotational. Mass is replaced with moment of inertia. Velocity is replaced with angular velocity. Linear displacement is replaced with angular displacement. Linear acceleration is replaced with angular acceleration. Linear momentum will be replaced with angular momentum. Linear momentum is mass into velocity. Angular momentum will be I into omega. Similarly, force is equal to mass into acceleration. Torque will be equal to I into alpha. Kinetic energy is equal to half mv square. Kinetic energy is equal to half I omega square. Am I clear with all these things? So that is why L is equal to I omega. So this is all about the introduction of linear momentum above a fixed axis. And the last concept that we need to know is, before that, I need to tell you the relation between torque and angular momentum. Tell me one thing, guys. So what does Newton's second law state? F is equal to, don't say M into A. Force is defined as the rate of change of something.
Rate of change of dp by dt.
So dp by dt, no. So torque, what should you get? Use the logic and tell me.
dl by dt.
That's it. Right. So let's see. We know that L is equal to I omega. Differentiate with t on both sides. So differentiate with time on both the sides. dl by dt will be equal to I into d omega by dt. Correct? So dl by dt will be equal to I into, what is d omega by dt? This is alpha. But what is this? This is torque. So torque will be equal to dl divided by dt. Okay. Now, as I mentioned, the last concept that we need to see is conservation of angular momentum. Can someone tell me what is conservation of linear momentum state? When external force is zero, what will happen? When external force is zero, linear momentum is said to be conserved. In a similar way, when can you say angular momentum is conserved?
When external torque is zero.
When external torque is zero, angular momentum is said to be conserved. That's it. That is a statement for conservation of angular momentum. External torque is equal to zero. Angular momentum of the system is said to be conserved. Okay. So when external torque is equal to angular momentum of the system is said to be conserved. Okay. So some of the examples of conservation of angular momentum is this dance. See, for example, a girl is sitting on a rolling chair, right?
I'm trying to show, but I'm not sure if it will work.
Okay, I'll try to demonstrate in chat. I don't know if it will work, but let me try. See, I'm also sitting on a rolling chair. Sitting on a chair which can revolve. Okay, now I will just revolve and show. I'll explain what exactly conservation of angular momentum means. The one that is there in the diagram. See, I will just apply some force and put myself into rotation. Okay, see. Are you seeing it okay? When I revolve like this, there is a possibility where I can extend my hands. See, when I keep my hands closer to each other, I'm revolving about the axis of rotation passing through the center of my body. If I'm divided into two parts, this is the axis of rotation with which I'm revolving. If I keep my hands closer, I repeat, if I keep my hands closer, will the moment of inertia of my body be more or less?
Less, sir.
Less, sir.
Why? Think about it, no? See, whenever you answer a question, no, think about it. What is moment of inertia? It is a product of mass and distance. So, with respect to the axis of rotation, if mass is distributed at a greater distance, moment of inertia will be more or less.
More, sir.
So, if it is distributed at a lesser distance, it will be less. So, when I am revolving, keeping my hands closer, then see, I am revolving like this, right? I am revolving at a certain speed. If suppose I extend and stretch my hands and keep it like this, let's see what will happen. I'm not sure if you guys can observe it. If you have this kind of a chair, revolve and see. Sorry. Okay. I'm just trying to extend my hand and see what will happen is I will tend to revolve with a greater speed. If somebody can actually put me into a revolution, right? I can do that faster. Now I'm not able to do because I myself am putting myself into revolution. So this is an example of conservation of angular momentum. I'll exactly explain with a mathematical equation. Only point I want you to remember is when my hands are closer, what will happen? Will the moment of inertia be less or more?
Less.
Yes. Okay. Whereas when my hands are stretched apart, what should happen? The moment of inertia should be
more. Sir.
Okay. So have this point. What to say here? Demonstration of conservation of angular momentum. A girl sits on a swivel chair or a rolling chair and stretches her arms or brings her arms closer to the body. So what is going to happen? So ask your friend to rotate the chair rapidly. While the chair is rotating with considerable angular speed, stretch your hands horizontally. What will happen? Your angular speed is reduced. Why? Because if you see, no, the whole rotation is taking place with the external torque being equal to zero. So once you are put into revolution, who is making you revolve? It is the momentum that is given to you is putting yourself into the continuous revolution. Correct? So when external torque is zero, can I say initial angular momentum is equal to the final angular momentum? That is a statement for conservation of angular momentum. So the more, the better way to write this is CC far far. That is moment of inertia of your body when the arms are closer and angular velocity when your arms are closer. Moment of inertia when the arms are extended and angular velocity when the arms are extended. So when this is going to be a constant, can I say that moment of inertia is inversely proportional to the angular velocity? Correct? Can I say that? See, A into B is a constant. Can I say A and B are inversely proportional? For it to be constant, If you are increasing the value of A, B should be decreased so that the product comes out to be a constant. You're able to understand. So can I say moment of inertia and angular velocity are inversely proportional? Now tell me, whether will I be able to revolve faster when my hands are closer or when they are stretched?
Hands are closed.
When they are closed.
Hands are closed. That is why, see, your angular speed is reduced. When the when you stretch your arms horizontally, your angular speed is reduced. It is because of what principle? Because of the principle of conservation of angular momentum.
Sir, this is also because of air resistance, right?
Let's assume there is no air resistance. It has nothing to do with air resistance because it will not be a much bigger factor to stop this to happen. Because not much of aerodynamics is going to come into consideration with respect to your body structure. Maybe you can talk about the flight wings and all those things because they are aerodynamically designed things. Whereas your hand and all, it's not a big thing. If you keep all those factors aside, it is purely because you are trying to change the moment of inertia of your body. That's the main reason. Okay. So when you're trying to change the moment of inertia, what is happening is the concept of conservation of angular momentum is recognized by your body and it tries to control the speed. That is what is happening. Not only me, if you have a rolling chair, try this out. Ask somebody to put it into revolution. You try to extend your hand, bring it closer. You yourself will observe a difference. But don't apply more pressure on the seat while you're sitting. Okay. So this is an example. And all other examples are given here, which you can go through. If you want, you can just Google and see all these images. Okay. So that's it with this chapter, guys. We are done with the chapter 7, rotation mechanics. So it is now your part to keep revising all the concepts. And Monday, we will try to do as many problems as possible. Okay. So that's it from my side.
So tomorrow, we don't have a problem.
Tomorrow, what is it? Tomorrow is Thursday.
Tomorrow. Oh, sorry. Yes, sir.
Yeah. Tomorrow you don't have any class. Okay. So that's it from my side. Guys, you guys ask me if there is any question. If there is nothing, we can wind up. Is there any other doubt? So everybody is having study material, right?
Yes, sir.
So go through the material that will make your job easy. I would not suggest you to read the textbook for this chapter because the textbook explanation is slightly tougher. You might not be able to understand. So you do two things. Have the videos of class lectures as reference and have the study materials beside you. Try to write down all the foreplay in one sheet. There will be a page called as concept map in the study materials that is given. I'm not sure if you guys have opened and seen it. Just before the NCRT solutions are there, at the end of the chapter, before NCRT solutions, there will be a page called as a concept map. Okay, that will connect you through all the concepts. That page will help you once you complete the whole chapter. Is that clear? So that you can ensure that no topic is skipped from your end. Go through that. Please, sir.
Sir, could you explain how is this principle used in diving?
Which is used in diving.
Yes, sir. It's written.
Same logic. When you bring your body closer, what will happen? See, when they dive, what do they do?
Initially, their hands will be white, sir. Only when diving.
When they revolve, when they keep revolving, you would have observed, they try to bring their legs closer to the chest. Right? Have you ever observed this? I'm not sure if you're a swimmer. I'm sorry to ask that question, but yeah. So they try to bring their legs closer to the chest, right? If they want to increase the speed and revolve faster. Generally what happens when they dive, they tend to make a turn and then fall, right?
Yes, sir.
So if they have to make more number of turns with a greater speed, what are they supposed to do? They actually need to shrink their body. Shrink their body in the sense, try to bring all the muscles as close as possible. Are you able to understand? So when they extend the hand initially, that is the time where their velocity will be less. Their angular velocity will be less. But if they have to increase their speed and revolve like this, they try to bring their legs closer to the chest. Especially the knees will come closer to the chest. You can observe that next time. Okay, when they do that, this time. So they try to increase their velocity by conserving the angular momentum, and then they fall into, they dive into the water. Okay, think about it. Clear? Anything else? That's it, guys. Anything else?
No, sir.
Then I think we are good to wind up, right? I'll see you all on Monday. So revise all the concepts and come. Okay. That's it, guys. You can leave.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.